I want to remind you we're having Holy Communion at the end of the message today, so be sure to have your communion elements ready. As we begin our series today on Jesus' prayer, I want us to read it together as it's found in Matthew 6, 9 through 13. Jesus, remember, said, "This then is how you should pray." Let's read together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. This is the word of the Lord. Well, hello, Christ Church friends, and all of you joining us for online worship. If you're with us on Facebook, say hello to other friends in the chat to let us know that you're here. If you're on the website, send us a prayer request or a praise report. That's another way that we can stay connected. So, how are you doing? How is it with your soul? I pray that you are drawing strength and courage, faith, hope, and love from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, even in the midst of these trying times. Today I'm continuing my series on Jesus' prayer. It is a practical prayer to help us in any and every time of need. Jesus' prayer is the best known prayer in the world. No other prayer is known to so many people or said in so many places and in so many different languages. Every Sunday in churches around the world, from the mud huts of Africa to the great cathedrals of Europe, from the country churches of rural Mississippi to the house churches of Hong Kong, in literally millions of churches, Christians of every denomination share this prayer as part of their worship experience. Last week we said the Lord's Prayer is central, a central document of the Christian faith. For 2,000 years, believers have pondered its meaning. It's like an inexhaustible well. The deeper you go, the more you find. It's simple, it's profound, it's what we need. Today we're looking at another phrase that Jesus used in his prayer, "Hallowed be your name." He said, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name." I think it's fair to say that this phrase is one that makes least sense to us, and so we don't think about it much when we say it. In the first place, it simply sounds strange. Hallowed is not a word that we use very often. The phrase itself sounds like it belongs back in the 12th century. We really don't know what to do with it in the 21st century. That's why some kids translate it, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name." Our other problem is we don't know what it means. Since we don't know what it means, we tend to skip right over it so we can get down to the part that we do understand. Give us this day our daily bread. Daily bread. Now that is something that makes sense to us. But it's of vital importance to note that Jesus didn't begin with the part that we understand, like bread and forgiveness. He starts with the part that we don't always understand. There's a critical point here. Jesus wants us to understand prayer doesn't begin with us. It begins with God. Prayer doesn't begin with our concerns. Prayer begins with God's concerns. A friend was recently reminding me of the ACTS model for prayer that he had learned. The acronym stands for Adoration, Confession, Thanksgiving, Supplication. It's an outline for prayer. It starts with adoration, a focus on God and who He is in the midst of our life. Prayer begins with God. So when we pray to the Father, we begin by praying, "Hallowed be your name." Let's take that word, hallowed. Hallowed means holy or sacred. When we build a new church, we often talk about it being hallowed ground, or when we lay our loved ones or soldiers to rest in cemeteries, we call it hallowed ground. It is set apart. It's a special place, holy ground. To hallow something is to treat it as sacred and holy and worthy of our highest reverence and respect. So a paraphrase of "Hallowed be your name" might be this: Lord, may your name be treated with respect and honor because your name is sacred and holy. We hallow God's name when we treat it with the utmost respect. According to Jesus, in praying to our Heavenly Father, we should do so with honor and respect because of who God is. God is holy, sacred. He is worthy. That immediately raises another question. Why did Jesus say, "Hallowed be your name"? What's in a name? Well, names mean something. They can communicate history and tradition and family heritage. How many of us were named after someone else? In the scripture, names communicate character or attributes. For example, Adam means man, and Eve means life giver. Abraham means father of multitudes, and Jacob means cheater. In the New Testament, Peter means rock, a reference to Peter's rock-like faith. In Bible times, when you called a person's name, you weren't just identifying them, you were also identifying with their character. We do the same thing today. We all tend to associate certain names with certain emotions. For instance, if I mention Hitler, you instantly think of Nazi Germany and the horrors of the Holocaust and the concentration camps. If I mention Mother Teresa, you think of her selfless work for the homeless and dying of Calcutta. Two people, two names, two completely different emotions. What pops up on your mental screen when you hear the word God? The answer depends on who you are and often how much you know. For most of us, the word God brings up images of the stories of the Bible, how God created the world out of nothing, how he parted the Red Sea for the children of Israel, how he caused the walls to come tumbling down at Jericho, how he enabled David's tiny stone to slay Goliath, how he shut the mouths of the lion so that Daniel could get a good night's sleep. We know God through the things he has done. We hear the stories and then we refer back to the God who stands behind the stories. God's name is his character and his reputation. In the scripture, God is given many names: creator, defender, deliverer, protector, provider, ruler, shepherd, sustainer, rock, fortress, shield, love. And that's just for starters. Psalm 8:1 reads, "How majestic is your name, O Lord." Psalm 27 reads, "Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will trust in the what? In the name of the Lord our God." How about this famous verse? "Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." It's found three times in the Bible. The Old Testament, Joel 2:32, and then in the New Testament, Acts 2:21 and Romans 10:13. God's name represents who he is. It embodies his character. That's why the third commandment says, "You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain." To take God's name in vain means to take it lightly or flippantly. It's the exact opposite of hallowing God's name. We might say that to hallow God's name means to take it seriously. Why do we hallow God's name? We hallow God's name because God is holy and God is worthy. Every now and then when I get into a bad place emotionally or spiritually, and we all might be experiencing more of that during this pandemic, you know, perhaps when I'm tired or things aren't going the way that I want, or a problem pops up out of nowhere, or a person says or does something and that's disappointing, or they don't do something and that's disappointing. We all have those times when we're spiritually and emotionally at the end of our rope. And in those moments, I often stop, I get out a pen and paper and I start trying to focus on God. I begin to just think of all the reasons that I have to praise Him, His glory, His creation, His holiness, power, love, His mercy, forgiveness. And I just start writing. Mountains, rivers, the ocean, the sky, wind, a thunderstorm. The creation manifests the glory of God. But our story doesn't end there with us just understanding God's character and attributes through His creation or His various names or the stories of His great power. It gets better. God wanted us to know Him even more intimately. He wanted us to have a real life picture of who He is and what His heart is truly like. So what did God do? He became one of us. If you want to know most completely what God is like, look at Jesus. When we look at Jesus, all those abstract ideas about God suddenly become reality. God now has hands and feet, eyes to see, ears to hear, lips to speak. God has a voice. He speaks a language that we understand. Hebrews 1:3 says this about Jesus. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of His being. Jesus the Son is the radiance, the shining brilliance of God's glory, magnificence, wonder. Jesus is the exact representation of God's being, God's presence, God's heart. When we see Jesus, we see God's heart. We hear His voice. We see Jesus touch a leper and we know no one is too dirty for God. We see Him pause to speak to a beggar and we know God is never too busy for me. We see Jesus feed the multitudes with loaves and fishes and we know that God can supply all my needs. We see Him with the towel and the basin and we know God meets me right there where I'm at. Finally, we see Jesus hanging on the cross, suspended between heaven and earth, beaten, bruised, bloodied, mocked, scourged, spat upon, jeered, booed, hated, attacked, scorned, despised, rejected, crucified. When we hear Him cry out, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do," we suddenly understand Jesus has no enemies. In Jesus, we discover a God who takes people seriously. He never treats people casually. He never brushes them off. He never says, "You're a loser." He's a God who cares enough to get involved in this ugly, twisted, unredeemed world. That's who God is. If He never took people lightly, then I must never take His name lightly. And yet too often, God's name is unhallowed in the world today. We don't revere it. We don't respect it. We don't honor it when we use God's name to curse our circumstances or to cuss some person in anger. We don't reverence and respect God's name when our language toward God or anyone else is jaded, cynical, dismissive. God's name is unhallowed when we value the approval of others more than the approval of God, when we judge the sins of others instead of mourning over our own sins, when we could care less about the plight of others in our world and are only concerned about, hey, what's happening to me? A few years ago, a major news organization reported on a survey that compared the ethical behavior of American Christians with the ethical behavior of the general public. The survey reportedly found that there was no substantial difference in the ethical behavior of those who called themselves Christians and the general population. Well, what kind of faith is that? How compelling is a faith like that? If a Christian under pressure loses his temper just like a non-Christian one does, or if she becomes just as nervous or anxious, or if He is just as greedy or just as gluttonous or just as cruel or as materialistic as the person next door. That is, if his religion, his faith doesn't actually change the way that they live, well, he or she shouldn't be surprised that his neighborhood evangelism doesn't win many converts. After all, why be converted to something that's not much different from what I already have? So here's a question. What would we see if we followed you around this week? Would your life show any difference because you're a Christian? Does the fact that you bear the name of Jesus Christ make a difference in the way that you live? That's really the bottom line on this prayer, this petition. When you pray, "Hallowed be your name," you're really praying, "Oh God, help me to live in such a way that your name is elevated in my life. May your reputation be increased in the world by the way that I live my life." Another question. Who is on the throne of your life? Some years ago, I remember seeing a little booklet about the Spirit-filled life, and inside the booklet, there were these three circles with a throne at the center of each one of the circles. In one circle, a cross was drawn outside the circle. That represented an unbeliever. Christ is still outside of their life. The next circle showed the cross inside the circle, but not on the throne. That represented a Christian who was still running his or her life. The last circle showed the cross inside the circle and above the throne. That represented the believer who had surrendered the throne of their life to Jesus Christ. I find those three circles very helpful and challenging. Each one of us fits into one of those three circles. Too many of us live in the middle circle, with Christ in our lives, but self still on the throne. I was thinking about my own experience again recently. I don't know how many times, even as a pastor, God has helped me to see that I have taken Him off the throne and I put myself back on there. Why? Because I just want to be in control. I don't naturally like the idea of yielding my will to Christ's will, of laying aside my plans for God's plans. Have you been there? Been there lately? We like to be the king of our own lives. That's why Jesus reminds us at the beginning of His model prayer, prayer begins with a focus on God, not on ourselves and on our needs. When you pray, "Hallowed be your name," when you pray it with understanding, you're really saying, "Lord Jesus, you be on the throne of my life." Praying, "Hallowed be your name," is life impacting. If you pray that God's name be revered, holy, and sacred, if you take that seriously, then you want to see that prayer fulfilled in your own life. We naturally want to be part of wonderful, successful things God is doing. But not everything God is doing is automatically wonderful and successful by the world standards. What if following God's call leads us to a hard place? To work in the midst of difficult circumstances where we may never see the fruit we hope for? What about being faithful during a pandemic, or standing up for Christ in our increasingly secular world? Remember Moses. For all his efforts, he didn't get to enter the promised land. Or Jeremiah the prophet. Throughout his life, he was rejected and scorned for speaking God's message. Sometimes God calls us out in the middle of some tough circumstances. This is where I need you to be faithful. It's not always easy. I know that for many, these last 8 months have been terribly difficult. We've probably all felt it to some degree or another. So many things have not been easy. But in my darker moments, I keep trying to stick close to Jesus. He's the one who knows about suffering, heartache, mental anguish. He knows about sorrow, abandonment, pain. He's been there. He knows. Remember this, Jesus' life, death, and resurrection remind us how far God is willing to go to reach us, to comfort us, to lead us, to save us. Amen? Amen. Amen. Hey, today as an act of thanksgiving and praise, we're going to celebrate Holy Communion. So get your elements there at home, crackers and juice, bread, whatever you plan to use. On the night that he gave himself up for us, we remember that Jesus gathered with his disciples. He took bread, he gave thanks, he broke the bread, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat this, all of you. This is my body, which is given for you. Do it in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice. In union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith, share this with me if you know it. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here online and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. So you may take your bread now. This is the body of Christ broken for you. Now take your juice. This is the blood of Christ poured out for you. Amen. Hey, in great gratitude, we have remembered and celebrated the great victory that Jesus Christ won on the cross for you and me. In the prayer he taught us, Jesus points us to our Heavenly Father who loves us, to the one whose name is holy and sacred and worthy of our praise. We celebrate our relationship with God our Father through faith in his Son, Jesus. Because he offered himself up for us, we have forgiveness of sins and new life in Christ. And with that new life in Christ comes the promised Holy Spirit to lead us and to guide us into all the truth. I pray that your heart will be filled with joy and gratitude again today because of everything God has done for you through his Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Hey, if you'd like to visit with me or someone about the message today, we want to hear from you. Perhaps you'd like to talk more about our Heavenly Father who loves you, whose name is sacred and holy and worthy to be praised. I'd love to talk further. Maybe you simply would say, "What I really need is Christ. I need him in my life so that I can know God the Father in this personal way, so that I can have peace with God, so that I can know the forgiveness that Jesus can give." Well, if that's you, I encourage you to pray this simple prayer. Jesus, I need your saving, cleansing, transforming grace. I want you to come into my life. I'm sorry for my sins. I believe you died for me. Right now, I trust you as my Savior and ask your Holy Spirit to come into my life. Hey, if you prayed that prayer, I'd say this. Welcome. Welcome into the family of God. What a great day for you and everyone who knows you. Tell somebody about your decision. I'd love to hear from you as well. Hey, if you have prayer requests or praise reports, we want to hear about them. Use the app or go to the website. If there are other needs in your life, let us know about those too. Thank you for your generous giving during this time. You've been texting to give or using the app. You've gone to the website. You mail in contributions. Again, thank you. Thank you. Your gifts enable us to continue our ministries of love and compassion to those in need. It's not too early to begin thinking about packing a shoebox gift for a child overseas. Dedication Sunday is November 22nd, so go online for details. Are you looking for a safe way to see your Christ Church family? Get this, our fellowship board is hosting Float the Park, a root beer float party at La Fortune Park on Sunday, October the 11th from 2 to 3:30. It's outside. We'll keep everybody safe. It's a great way to connect with your CUMC friends. Are you parenting young children and looking to share with others? Our monthly parent-to-parent meeting is this Tuesday night, October the 6th at 7 p.m. by Zoom. Contact Chris Miracle or this week's newsletter on the website for Zoom details. I hope you take advantage of our various discipleship opportunities and find all the information you need on our website, cumctulsa.com. God bless you today. Remember, we have a Heavenly Father who loves us, one whose name is sacred and holy and worthy of our praise. We celebrate our relationship with God our Father through faith in His Son Jesus. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Hey stranger, how's it going?
It's good. It's gonna be a great day.
So what are you doing?
I'm getting ready to float the park.
But,
well, I've missed my church family and I heard that we were gonna float the park and I thought, I am all in.
Are you serious?
Who are you talking to?
Float the park is a root beer float party at the park. You're not actually floating on the water.
Wait, what?
Float the Park is a root beer float party, ice cream social, if you will, at La Fortune Park, put on by the Fellowship Board. They're gonna have cute little root beer float kits. The children's and youth ministries are gonna do games. It's a good way for us to get together safely. And you know, we all miss our church family.
Oh, so I don't get to wear my floaty or my snorkel. But, you know ice cream, right?
I mean, yes, there will be ice cream and root beer and walking and talking, you know, games.
Okay. So join Christ Church for Float the Park, an ice cream social with root beer floats, some assembly required, games provided by children's and youth. We can walk, we can talk, we can sit. We can see each other because we do all miss our church family.